Welcome to our Subcommittee on General Government and Local Assistance. I'm Sandy Galef and chair of the Real Property Taxation Committee in the Assembly. And I am joined by Senator Skoufis, who will speak right after I just give some opening remarks. I'd just like to say that this has been a year like no other. I don't even know whether we had conference committees last year. I don't think we actually did because we kind of left Albany. And obviously we had a tremendous impact on our 2020-21 state budget because of COVID. We are very, and I am very thankful, I think we all are thankful to our U.S. Senators and our congresspeople who provided us a great deal of assistance through the COVID-19 stimulus program, which will be very helpful to us as we deal with the budget. And, you know, as we all know in New York, we were impacted more heavily probably than any other state because we were the epicenter in the very beginning and trying to figure out what to do with PPE and what to do with not enough hospital beds and how to protect our residents. So it was really a difficult year for us. But I was, as I reviewed the Assembly and the Senate resolution, I realized it's a better year. So it's exciting. There are a lot of areas where the Assembly and Senate has agreed on spending or agreed on policies. And in some areas, we've also agreed with the governor as we go forward. In some areas, we have different approaches. I just wanted to, in a general term, say that in the Assembly resolution, there were many items that we rejected or took out of our resolution because they were policy decisions. They had nothing really to do with budget and spending. And we wanted to address those separately from the budget and give, more evaluation of each of them. And many of the proposals that the governor's made probably, will be positively entertained, and there are others that may be amended as we go forward. But I just thought that would be it's important to comment about why some things are not in the Assembly resolution. And now I'd like to turn it over to Senator James Skoufis. And it's a pleasure working with you on this committee.
Likewise, thanks very much, Assemblywoman Galef. I'm delighted to join you as co-chair and our colleagues here at this conference committee. And as you, I think you summed it up well, you're sort of bringing us to this moment and what's transpired over the past few months since the budget process started and transpired over the past year, the challenges of the pandemic and us now trying to come out of the pandemic stronger than ever. And I do think that our One House budgets attempt to do just that, and if implemented, would do just that. And at this particular table, or conference committee, I should say, we're dealing with general government and local government programming, services, spending, which is sort of a catch-all. Deal with a lot of agency spending, election items, local government services, and so we're going to attempt to deal with a lot at this conference committee, and look forward to the work with all of you. Just a few highlights from our Senate One House. We put additional money in for early voting, which we saw firsthand, really for the first time in a real way, the successes, overwhelming success of early voting in the presidential election last year. We look to restore the AIM cuts that the governor had proposed, as well as joining the Assembly, both of our One House budgets. Look to decouple the AIM funding from last year's internet sales tax intercept scheme that was put in place. Lastly, the last item I'll note from our Senate One House is we look to add $15 million for local code enforcement, which is imperative at any time, but I would argue is more important than ever now. And so I look forward to the work with all of you, and I'll now introduce my Senate colleagues who are on this conference committee, and they include Senator Gorin, Senator Gnardis, Senator Jackson, Senator Rath, and as alternates, Senator Cooney and Senator Ritchie.
And I would like to introduce those in the assembly that are on this conference committee. Fred Thiel, who is chair of local governments. Victor Pichardo, who is chair of banks. Ed Bronstein, who's chair of cities. Marianne Budenschon, who's an alternate. And Taylor Darling, who's an alternate. And in the assembly minority, Carl Brabenak, who is ranking member of the labor committee. And Brian Miller, who is an alternate and a ranking member of the Real Property Tax Committee.
The recording secretary on the Senate side will be Alex Pollinger.
And on the Assembly side, the recording secretary for the Assembly will be Kaylee McTagg.
So I know, just to outline the agencies that we're dealing with, the areas of jurisdiction here at this conference committee. Among others, we're going to look at the Division of Alcoholic Beverage Control, Department of Audit and Control, also known as the Comptroller's Office, the Division of Budget, Executive Chamber, J-COPE, Department of Financial Services, Office of General Services, General State Charges, Office of Inspector General, Department of State, Department of Taxation and Finance, Division of Tax Appeals, Office of Information Technology Services, Local Government Assistance, and the statewide financial system. I will open it up to any Senate colleagues who would like to make any remarks, if any of you would like to make any remarks. Senator Gorin.
Thank you, Senator. Just to follow up on what you have said and what Chair Galef said, I think one of the things that is significant in this budget in the 2-1 houses is that there is a determination made by both houses that we really want to go away from this system of just loading the budget up with all sorts of policies and legislation that doesn't necessarily have any real impact on the budgetary process. And so I think it's important to note that, because obviously there are many things that are important that many of us support that we're omitting from the governor's proposal. But I also think it's important that we get an answer soon on whether or not there will be a three-way agreement to omit all of this, because some of the issues that we are omitting are really very substantive and important to this state, and require some thought and debate. So, but hopefully we will get an answer to that soon. And I, share in some of the comments that were made about the restoration of AIM and some of the other issues. So looking forward to working with everyone.
Thanks, Senator Gorin. I see Senator Rath, you'd like to say something?
Yes, thank you very much, Senator Skoufis. And it is my honor to serve on this budget subcommittee, and appreciate the opportunity to share a few comments and perspective. First and foremost, very encouraged with regards to the restoration of the AIM money and the importance of that for all of our cities, towns, and villages. Coming from the county legislature, I know directly how important AIM money is reaching across all of New York State. It doesn't matter what your affiliation is, this is the right thing to do. So I'm very, very happy for that and very proud for that, and hope that we continue to stand up to the governor with regards to any types of games that he's been trying to play with this AIM funding in the past. Also, I do want to touch on a couple of concerns that I have, and I brought this up the other day. This has to do with the VLT money and the fact that there are certain counties and certain communities right now that are being shortchanged or left out of the VLT money, specifically Saratoga County and Genesee counties. It's really inexplicable to me to see that those counties are excluded from the VLT money, particularly somewhere like Saratoga. That is a hospitality community, and they have been suffering like no one else, and certainly Genesee County, which is right in the heart of my district. So I'm really hoping for the restoration of that money, and look forward to really working with all of my colleagues on this committee. And let's just certainly keep in contact. And, once again, it's an honor to be here. Thank you, folks.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you, Senator Rath. I see Senator Jackson, you have your hand up.
Thank you. Thank you, and good afternoon, everyone. So thank you for the introductions from both the co-chairs. I agree with Senator Gorin about loading up our budgetary process with policy matters that should be taken outside of the budget. But obviously, we are new at this in relationship to the Democrats being leadership in the state Senate. So I know that it's not going to be done instantaneously, but I do expect over time that we will move a lot of stuff.
Having a service issue with Senator Jackson.
If we get him back on, why don't we circle back? And in the meantime, I don't see any other Senate hands, so I'll turn it over to you, Assemblywoman Galef.
All right, Assemblyman Thiel.
Thank you, Assemblymember Galef.
Should not be in budgetary process. Excuse me?
Oh, wait a second. Senator Jackson is in with his closing.
Maybe. You froze up there for a minute or so, Senator Jackson.
So let me do this. Let me go into my hotspot so I'll be able to talk in its entirety. Why don't you go to the next senator or assembly member, okay?
Okay, we'll circle back.
Okay. Fred?
Well, thank you. Take two. Thank you, Assemblymember Galef. And it's a pleasure to be part of the General Government Subcommittee for the Budget. And I look forward again to working with my counterpart in the Senate with local government, Senator Gorin. And, certainly I do think that we share a lot of interests and have a lot in common as we try to put together a final budget. The passage of the American Recovery Plan for the state of New York and for local governments, $350 billion nationwide, and makes a big difference as we put this budget together with regard to local governments. But just as we expected the federal government to meet its responsibility to the states, the local governments have every right to expect the state to meet its responsibility to them. And that means making sure that they get their full share of state assistance. And as we've spoken, AIM is a critical part of that, not just restoring the money, but going back to 2018 and getting rid of the county intercept on sales tax, making this the state responsibility that it should be. The Assembly One House has $125 million more for AIM. Hopefully we'll be able to discuss that. Equally important, as was mentioned here, is the VLT aid, and to make sure that all communities that are involved with VLT, and I see the Senate has been creative there, that we address that issue also. And working together, hopefully we can come up with a budget that does meet that responsibility to local governments. They are our partners. They have been on the front lines during this pandemic every step of the way, and the final budget should reflect that priority. Thank you very much.
All right, Carl?
Hello. Yes, good afternoon, everybody. Hope everyone's doing well, and glad to be on this conference committee this year. Just have a small statement on behalf of the Minority Conference and the 5.6 million people that we represent all across the state of New York. So our conference is calling for the following items to be prioritized during budget negotiations. Eliminate the unnecessary withholding of $250 million in sales tax, $200 million for New York City, and $50 million for all other counties to fund the distressed hospital fund. We believe significant federal funding has been provided to health facilities throughout this pandemic, and with this withheld funding is no longer needed. While we are happy to see the Assembly Majority Budget Proposal repeal the upcoming fiscal year sales tax intercept, we need to go further and reimburse counties and New York City the sales tax that was already withheld. Increase direct support for under and unfunded mandates that are placed on local governments. If we pass it, we should pay for it. And that should be our policy. Any under or unfunded mandate placed on local governments just becomes a property tax hike for all of the homeowners. We need to protect our overtaxed and overburdened real property taxpayers. Third, we need to provide real, meaningful, real property tax relief by looking at the true cost drivers impacting our local governments and school districts and requiring the state to act on these rather than creating a circuit breaker property tax break, which just places the Band-Aid on the problem. Our conference is also concerned over several of the governor's proposals, including the governor's proposal to cut the aid and incentives for municipalities, the AIM program, and further requiring all town and village AIM payments to be paid for by county sales tax. The AIM program was created by the state as a funding mechanism for local government assistance, and it needs to continue to be a state-supported program. This year's enacted budget must repeal the requirement for the AIM program to be funded via local sales tax. We are pleased that both majorities fully restore governor's AIM cut and eliminate the unfunded mandate that was placed on the counties. As you know, the governor's proposals the governor proposes to eliminate video lottery terminal VLT aid for all municipalities outside of Yonkers, totaling $9.3 million and a reduction of 5% for the city of Yonkers. This funding is important for these local governments as it helps provide important infrastructure support as a result from being a host community of VLTs and should be fully restored. Finally, the two majorities rejected the governor's proposal that would extend local government's authority to piggyback on competitively bid contracts from the federal government and or many state and local governments. This executive budget proposal is a common sense approach to helping local governments reduce costs and should be included in the final budget. So we hope that the budget negotiations continue to take place in a public transparent manner. And we can do more for our local governments across the state by implementing a lot of these proposals. So thank you again, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Carl. You obviously had a lot to say. Are there any other assembly members that would like to comment? If not, we'll go back to the senator.
Senator Jackson.
Thank you. I've switched to my hotspot because obviously, even in New York City, we have broadband issues and connectivity issues. So I appreciate you bearing with me during my trouble and making sure my two cents is heard clearly and definitively. So I did agree with my colleague, Jim Gorin, about that the policy issues, we need to be able to flush that out of the budgetary process. And I know that cannot be done immediately, but in due time, I hope that that happens because there's a lot of things that we need to do actually within the budget that should not include policy stuff. That's number one. Number two, I heard one of my colleagues in the assembly talk on behalf of the Republican minority. And the bottom line is this is a joint committee. And I frankly represent the city's committee on the state Senate, and that city's committee is number one, which is New York City. But you will always hear me talk about all of New York State, not only New York City. And that's very, very important to me because we're all in this together. And we're going to address it together, both the Assembly and Senate, the majority and the minority. Some people may disagree with that, but that's the way I feel. And maybe I'm still relatively new in the New York State Senate. I came in January 2019, but I'm going to stay new in order to have that position that I take, that I'm after, to make sure that everyone is taken care of in this state. And so with that, I say that the three main issues that impact my constituents and the constituents of New York State is making sure that they're not evicted from their homes and evicted from their apartments, making that we have enough food to eat, and making sure that there's enough health care for everyone, especially the mental health that's impacting so many people around the state. And then finally, to make sure that a foundation aid is thoroughly put out. Now, you may say, wait a minute, that's education. Well, that's local government too, because that's New York City and I represent New York City, but I'm sure that I represent many of the other cities and local governments that have come in front of the Joint Budget Committee hearings and testified about the negative situations of the executive budget. So I say to all of you, that I look forward to working with you on all of the issues that has been outlined by Jim Skoufis with respect to all of the agencies within the state of New York, which is a lot of them. But I thank you all, and I hope to cooperate fully and deliberately in respect to making sure that we make the best recommendations on behalf of all New Yorkers. And thank you for your cooperation.
Well said, and always well said, Senator Jackson. And I think that's a good place to end, unless I see any other hands pop up. On that note, we are still awaiting a table target, but as was mentioned, we look forward to working collaboratively within this committee in a joint manner, both houses, majority, minority, over the next couple of weeks towards a final product. So, Sandy, Assemblywoman Galef, please.
Right. I just wanted to add a little bit in the area of real property taxation, if I could. I know both houses have rejected the proposal to have enhanced star recipients get a credit check instead of having an exemption from their school taxes. So hopefully that will continue. And I know we're both working on the mobile homeowner issue, but I just wanted to follow up on a little of these policy matters outside the budget. Just for reference, actually for the governor, is we have in the assembly passed a number of election bills that some were stated in the budget. And then last night, we actually passed the Veterans Treatment Court, which was a standalone bill, but also was in the budget. So we can do these things without being in the budget. That's what I'm trying to say. They're program bills. They have no, it's not in a budget with a financial issue. And I think we should just be sure at the end of the day that we are separating those pieces of legislation out of the budget. I look forward to working with all of you as we continue our negotiations.
So that, I think, concludes our meeting today, and we will await the call of the main conference committee as far as when we'll meet next. Until then, thanks everyone.
May I just say one last thing I forgot to say?
Yeah, of course, sure.
I appreciate all of my colleagues that talk about congratulating us for restoring AIM and some even going further. And I can understand if I represented your area, I would want that also. But I raise to you, and it may not be taken up, but I have to raise it. New York City lost its AIM long time ago, and that's hundreds of millions of dollars. And as I said to my colleagues, I will be raising this on a continuous basis because it impacts New Yorkers. New York City is the only municipality that does not receive AIM funding. And so if you're not aware of that, so please be advised, and please be advised I'm gonna raise that because that's very important to New York City. You may say, well, we're getting ours. You may be getting yours, but New York City is not getting ours. I just raised that to everyone's be FYI. Thank you, Madam Chair and Mr. Chair.
I expect no less. Thank you, Senator Jackson. And unless there are any other final words, we'll meet again shortly. Thanks, everybody.
Have a good evening.